Welcome to the discipleship course. As we go on today, let's pray. Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the living God, we are praying that you lead us into the very presence of the Holy God, that you will take the things of the Christ and show them to us. Lord, we want to see Jesus. Help us, O God, take away the veil from our faces and grant us to behold him as in a glass so that we can change to become like him. Lord, walk again in this hour, in Jesus' name we prayed. Thank you so much for joining this cruise. Even if you are joining it for the first time by chance or by invitation from a friend, this is the cruise. The cruise is the cruise that takes us across the sea of lifestyle. Our journey through the earth is like a journey through the oceans, through the seas, through the rivers. We cannot get onto the side that God is taking us unless there is a sheep, and that sheep is what we call the disciples' sheep. There are friendships, there are courtships, there are partnerships, but the one sheep that will take you across from the negative side where you are to the positive side of God is the discipleship. In this sheep, Jesus is the captain, and other followers of Christ are inside this sheep. I hope you have embarked. If you have not embarked into the ship, today is your day. God wants you to enter this ship because there are going to be storms. And without Jesus being the captain, the storms will capsize your ship. I hope you're not in the wrong ship, to a wrong relationship, because that will seal a doom for your life. Let's go on. Things are getting tougher, things are getting darker. The messages, the news is not complimentary. But let me warn you again, you must live your life to the fullest. Time does not wait for you. Any day wasted in life cannot be recouped. God said, therefore, seize every opportunity, redeeming the time because the days are evil. So let's go on, since our time is already fixed and there are certain things to accomplish within that time. We must beg God to be merciful to us. The present distress, the present fear, has been all prophesied long, long ago by the Lord himself. And since he has told us so, we shouldn't be in darkness. We should be able to trust him now to take us through this period until either we get to heaven to meet him or he comes to rapture us. But the days are going to be difficult. But those who put their trust in Jehovah shall be like Mount Zion that shall not be moved. God will not allow you to be moved. God will not allow you to sink in a time like this. God will not allow the storms that are beginning to rage to overwhelm you. Because Jesus is their captain and the captain of the ship, you will sail through by the grace of God. And not just you yourself, your family will sail through in the name of Jesus Christ. I'd like to keep telling you as we go on, that God wants to use you. The Bible says in the book of Jeremiah chapter 29. Jeremiah chapter 29. Let me read it for you because it's very critical for us to base whatever we say on the word of God. It's our authority. Jeremiah 29. Verse 11. Say, for I know the thoughts that I think toward you, said the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. God is thinking thoughts towards you. He's thinking about you. He's making plans for you. He has an objective for your life. That's what the Lord is saying to us. He says his thoughts for you are thoughts of peace and not of evil. God wants you to live in peace. God wants you to gain momentum. God wants to move forward because he's going to bring you to an expected, and there's an expectation in his heart concerning your life. And that's where God wants to bring you. Your enemy and the enemy of God may not be happy about it, but there's nothing he could do if you cooperate with God. He wants to bring you to an expected end. There's an expectation in his heart concerning your life. Not just to bring you to heaven, but there are certain things that he has ordained for you to enter into in your lifetime before you come to heaven. And for this, he must prepare you. That's why we are talking about discipleship, training, preparation, so that you can be able to fit into every position that God has ordained for your life. And we keep saying this, it may look like a tautology, a repetition, but truly speaking, unless it gets into your heart deeply that you need to be trained for whatever you are going to do for God in life, you may take it for granted. People that fail, they didn't plan to fail, they only failed because they didn't plan. And any man that does not plan, that is not proactive, that does not make arrangement for the coming day, will be shocked at what will happen. As I pass through this life, I see a lot of broken, fragmented lives that they cannot be useful. It is because when they were supposed to be making preparation for the future, they were joking. They took it for granted. Some people went to school, they took school for granted. When they were supposed to be in the classroom, they were truants on the road. When they were supposed to be taking exams, they thought there's a way out of it. In Nigeria, many things are possible. You can buy a certificate, you can do anything, but that is not the end of the matter. The matter is that it's not the certificate you get that matters nowadays, but what you can produce from your life. Several people, when they would have learned what could have helped them in life, they were truants. They were looking for money instead of bending down to learn carpentry, to learn a trade, to learn a vocation. And today, they have a wife, or they may not even be able to marry a wife. They may have children, and everybody around them is disadvantaged because there's no training. So we must not allow the devil to cheat us again. There's a requisite training, a requisite discipleship for anything you are going to do in life. If you are going to pursue God's purpose with your life, and I'm not talking about being a preacher, no matter what your professional background may be, if you want to pursue the purpose of God for your life, to bring that expected end for your life, then you must be ready. The first years of your life must be years of preparation. And in preparation, God domesticates. There are many women who are housewives, but they are not domesticated. They cannot handle the issues of the domestic, the home. They cannot manage. And therefore, their husbands and their children become unfortunate. No matter how energetic a life is, if that life is not harnessed, you don't tie it down, and you don't train it, that life cannot produce for God. Let me show you again from the book of Job, chapter 39, where God asked Job a series of questions. Job was a godly man. The devil targeted him and did a lot of havoc in his life. Job couldn't understand it. And Job said many, many, many things in defense of his righteousness. He didn't let God vindicate him. When God was going to vindicate him, God also asked him several questions. Several questions. And I want to read it for you from verse 5. It was God who was questioning Job here. He said, verse 5, who has sent out the wild ass free? Who has loosed the bands of the wild ass? Whose house I have made the wilderness and the barren land is dwellings, is cornered the multitude of the city. Did I regard it the crying of the driver? The range of the mountains is his pasture, and he searcheth after every green thing. Will the unicorn be willing to serve thee, or abide by my crib? Canst thou bind the unicorn with his band in the furrow, or will he harrow the valleys after thee? Will thou trust him because his strength is great, or will thou leave thy labor to him? Will thou believe him that he will bring home thy seed, and gather it into thy barns. Let me stop here. Then God took another animal. And God kept querying Job. He kept querying Job. He said he darkens knowledge because of lack of understanding. God is supreme. God is preeminent. God is almighty. God is all-knowing. He created us, and we should depend on Him and listen to Him. For every animal you see in the house that is useful, a donkey, a cow that is useful to that family, there was some domestication. There was some training. Otherwise, they will not be useful. No life can become useful without training. Your children will not become useful except they are trained. A child left to himself will only bring shame to the family. Foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child. Only the rod of correction will drive it away. That's what the book of Proverbs says. We see two animals here. The first question, and there are several questions, which Job was supposed to answer, which he should try to answer. Who has sent out the wild ass? Who sent him? Who sent him? Who has loosed the bands of the wild ass? Who sent the wild ass? Who released him? Nobody. That's the answer. And you that you are doing many, many things, who sent you? Who sent you? Sorry. Where were you sent for? Or who loosed the bands of the wild ass? Who tied the wild ass that one day they loosed him? No, these are principles you must take cognizance of. Who sent him? Who loosed the bands? When was he ever tied down? In my grandmother's house, when I was growing up, I used to go on holidays there once in a while. I noticed that some goats in that house were very, very wild. They would eat soap. They would eat clothes. If you left your clothes on the ground, they would eat it. If you left your clothes on the line, and they can jump and get the weight. If you came back from school and left your notebooks on the table, and they entered the house, they will eat your notebooks. They ate anything. They were as destructive. And my grandmother did something that amazed me. He will set a trap for them, put some grass on some food on the ground, and when they come, we cut them and put them down and put a rope on their neck and tie them somewhere. And after some time, when they are released from that place they tied them, where they were loose from, then they stopped eating all those things and began to eat what they were trained to eat when they were tied down. Why are you so destructive? When were you loose from the bands? The wild ass, us, is a wild donkey. The wild donkey, there's a tame donkey, there's a wild donkey. The wild donkey, nobody ever loosed him, nobody ever tied him, nobody ever sent him forth. When a man is going to do well in life, they had to tie him for some time and send him forth into what he's going to do for God. That is the order. But a wild ass didn't go through that process. He said, whose house I have made the wilderness, and the barren land is his dwelling place. That's where he lives. The wilderness, the barren land. That's where rebels normally stay. People who cannot stay inside a family, who cannot head together, who cannot flock together, who have not been trained, who are raw. Their house is in the deserts. Barren lands. They wander around. They are scavengers. They are rangers. Rangers. Are you a ranger? Are you an independent ranger? Nobody controls you. Nobody asks you, where are you coming from? Where are you going? Nobody has ever tied you down to talk about losing you. Now, you may think that you're enjoying freedom. All animals in the meantime who are not tied up may think they're enjoying freedom. But friend, that's a false freedom. In time to come, you will discover that the consequences of that kind of false freedom is too dangerous. When the time comes, the range of the mountain is his pasture. He fends for himself, always searching everywhere to look for anything green, that wild ass. When you are independent, when you're a ranger, a lone ranger, then you have to fend for yourself. That's not the will of God for your life. God wants to be responsible for you, but he has to train you so that you can fit into his purpose. He said, if you seek first of all his kingdom and his righteousness, every other thing shall be added unto you. Let's leave the ox, the donkey. Will the unicorn be willing to serve you and abide by thy crib? Job, Evelyn, Ephraim, will the unicorn be willing to serve you and abide by thy crib? Unicorn is the strongest, one of the strongest animals. Is the wild cow in the bush. If a unicorn meets you in the bush, I'm sorry for you. I had a story about people who went into the game reserve. They were in their Land Rover, and suddenly they came into the environment of some wild cows, and they suffered for it. Even though they were inside the vehicle, the way those horses, I mean those cows with their unicorns, their power, their horns, hit that car, it capsized. Friend, very great strength. Your strength may be very great, intellectual strength, even raw strength, may be very great. You may have power, all kinds of strength, very powerful. But the Bible said, will the unicorn be willing to serve thee with all his great power? Will it come near thee and serve thee, or abide by thy crib? Will you leave it to tread out your corn in your house and look after your thing? Will it serve you? Can you bring a wild horse, cow to your house to serve you? Will you not just create trouble for yourself? Will you have any peace in that house? Won't you be running away and lock your door against that, because it's going to hit you down? Will it serve you? Will it going to be willing to serve you? Abide by thy creed. Too many times I see a lot of wild people, and the remedy, let's go for deliverance. There's a demon troubling this man, my friend. It is not always a demon that is troubling somebody. Yes, I know that when a demon possesses somebody, their strength can be very great. And a small girl can resist big, tall men and huge men and push them down. But there are very rare cases like that. All these wild children that you have raised in your home, who have never been under authority, who have never been tied down, they have great strength. Some of them have great abilities. But can they serve you? Are they useful to you? Can you leave your house and say, I'm coming back in 2 hours' time. Can they cook food? Can they do this? Can they do that? When you return, what do you normally see in your house? Is it not confusion? They will break bread. They will break pot. Even the food they cooked with all their ability. And they're fighting everywhere. This one will slap this one. This one will push this one. Destructive. Every error, is it not because there is no training? I want to pray with you. Even in your home, there's a need for discipleship training. If you are going to ever be have peace and be happy, and if your generation after you can even manage what small things you have gathered, I was wondering why you are spending so much energy gathering something. You built a house, you have property in your house, you have a car, you are struggling to have this and that. For what? For who? When you're no longer here, into whose hands are you going to commit those things? Is he a wild unicorn? Verse 10 says, can thou bind the unicorn with the band in the furrow? Or will he harrow thy valleys after thee? Will he use it to till your farm? They normally bind two animals and then they will be furrowing. They will be in the farm, harrowing. Will you trust him because his strength is great? Or will you leave your labor to him? Will you trust him? Because his strength is great. Do you normally trust people because of their great energy? You discover in life, people that are trusting are not people that have great energy and great abilities. You may want to trust them, but they are not trustworthy. It's not strength that makes a man to become trustworthy. Because by strength shall no man prevail. What makes a man trustworthy, actually, is because he's no longer a stranger to you. He has been trained and has been tested. And he can be responsible. If he says, do this for me, you will do it. He has been trained. Nobody who has not been trained can be trusted. No matter how wonderful and how beautiful and how handsome and how great their strength are, they cannot be trusted. That's the reason why we can't afford to joke with this subject matter. If a life is not harnessed, if a life is not trained, would I believe him that he will bring home thy seed and gather it into thy barn when they finish farm work? And they bring out the corn and all the grains and all the tubers. They put it on the back of a cow and send it home. The cow knows the way home. He takes it back to the barn. Will you trust, oh my God, a unicorn to carry your farm produce back to the house? Will you find it when you get home? You see, it is foolishness to try to trust some people. You will regret it. They were never trained to be trusted. They were never helped. How can you trust them with your produce, with your labor? You are trusting a house girl with your children when that house girl was never trained. What result are you expecting without training? A CEO who hires an untrained hand is only hiring trouble and destruction for himself. That's why before they go to hire a person who is going to serve in a position in the industry, they normally go through many, many, many exams and many tests and put him on probation to check whether he can be able to stand in this office. And they don't give him something serious to start with. Friend, if human beings are wise like this, don't you think that God, the all-knowing God, will not trust a man who is not trained? Look at Petro. When they bring it out from the ground, it is dark oil. It's not almost useless. But by the time it goes through a refining in the refinery, and they heat it with heavy temperature, you see petrol, you see diesel, you see all kinds of products, Vaseline and every product. But without that training, that refining, won't you allow God to sit over your life and refine you? Will you ever be useful to God in your condition? Jesus cannot ride an ass that is not tied down. He will carry him into the bush. He's always looking for grass here and there. He can't move straight. I see many young people that cannot go straight. They were never trained to sit down in one place. They were never trained to be straightforward. They were never trained to be responsible. The kind of people we are seeing all around us nowadays. Independent rangers. If I call them a vagabond, you will look at it to say I'm insulting them, but that's an English word. They are not dependable, they are not trustworthy. When I go to the book of Hosea, as I close, Hosea, now I'm making a case. There's a need for you to bend down, there's a need for you to submit yourself to God. There's a need for you to beg God to show you mercy. Again, the last verse. Hosea chapter 10 verse 11. And Ephraim is an ephah that is taught and loveth to tread out the corn. But I have passed over a fair neck. I will make Ephraim to ride. I will make Judah to plow. And I will make Jacob. And Jacob shall break the clubs. What's God saying here? Ephraim, Israel. Ephraim is another name for Israel. Ephraim is the firstborn. I mean, the second son of Joseph that was elevated ahead of his brother, and he becomes synonymous with the northern kingdom. He said Ephraim is an ephah. It's a cow that is taught. It has been taught. It has been trained.
And he loved to tread out the corn. He loved to tread out the corn. The Bible says, don't muzzle the ox that treads out the corn. When you bring the corn in, they have to match it. They have to tread it. They have to thresh it. They have to take away the chaff and bring in the produce. When the corn is treading out, when the cow is treading out the grain, he must not stop it from eating. So as he's doing, it's eating. And Ephraim loves it to tread out the corn because it will be eaten as he's treading. God said, but I have passed over upon his fair neck. There's a training I have not given. Even though he's taught, there's a training I have not given him. I've not broken his neck yet. I've not broken his strength yet. And therefore, Ephraim cannot plow. I mean, Judah cannot plow and Jacob cannot break the clocks. So even though you have been trained to a certain extent, there are still some training to give you if you are going to plow, if you are going to be utmostly useful in your day and your time. And therefore, again, can I invite you? Can I beg you? Can I solicit that your trouble is not demon? It's not demon. It's not every time that somebody is doing remote control and trying to make you to fail in life. All those your false prophets who are always telling you that it is somebody in your village, somebody who your father did business with, who didn't return the money, your mother's mate, that they are the ones who are trying to destroy your life. And you go to a place, they say they took your name somewhere, and all those kind of stories. It's trash. There are some people that are untouchables. You should be an untouchable. You should get to the point where nobody can take your name anywhere and call your name inside a bucket of water or a glass of water. And your name will appear. You should get to a point where because you are in the law, nobody can harm you because you are covered by the blood, because you are in the covenant. But because you have not been trained, there are so many things that are going wrong with your life. You can't marry, you can't build a home, you can't plow. So can you please say to God, as I pray with you now, Lord, I submit myself to training. Deal with me as thou seest me. However you want to train me, whoever you want to use as your instrument, whatever how you are going to arrange it, I don't care. But Lord, I submit my neck. I submit my neck. If you are doing that, just lay your hand on your head, wherever you are. Father, Lord, you hear prayers. Your word does not return to you void. I have given an invitation on your behalf. Lord, harness this life that are putting their hands on their neck and confessing that it is time for them to be trained. Lord, training is difficult when somebody is old, but yet, as these ones submit themselves to you know the best and how to do it. Lord, produce something good out of their life and bring them to the expected end. Defeat the enemy in their lives and let your name be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray.
For further inquiry or counsel, contact Righteous Media Center, number 1, Refuge Close, Ongwambarde, Sabon Tasha, Kaduna. Telephone numbers 0814-408-9412, 0805-845-5719. Email address, thresholdsteam@yahoo.com. Or you could visit our website at www.thresholdsteam.org.ng.